Welcome to episode 31 of The Right to Reason. I'm your host, Robert Stanley. Great episode today. Very cool guest. But before I get into that, I want to let you guys know that we have had a considerable reduction in subscribers lately because of our recent episode dealing with transgender rights. About one third of our listeners have cut us from their regular listening regimen. You can imagine what that does to a production. 33% is no small amount. You might be wondering how I feel about it. What's my response? Are we going to start curbing our discussions away from controversial issues? Are we going to start placating to the sentimentalities of our audience? Try not to offend people, maybe. Try to play nice. You know what I say? I say we just opened up the windows of this broadcast and got some fresh air in here. I say to hell with anyone that has a problem with LGBTQ rights. And what kind of a snowflake are you if you can't even hear about someone different from you being treated fairly? I have no patience for those kinds of bigots. I'm glad they're gone. We need to do some real introspection in this community, guys, about what viruses and parasites it has growing throughout. I'm preaching the choir here. I know. You guys are the ones that stayed. And I thank you. I thank you for your support and for having our backs, for supporting the odd atheist friends of the show, for supporting gay and trans rights. Thank you for representing the Right to Reason community with class and courage and empathy to others. That's what we're about. I need your help now more than ever. We need to get these numbers back up. And I do this for a living, people. My marketing schedule is full. I'm booking guest appearances on other shows. I'm purchasing ads. I'm working for you here, all right? I just need you guys to help me out. If you're not a Patreon subscriber, swing over to patreon.com/right. A dollar goes a long way if you consider the cumulative effect of multiple listeners helping out. If you can't, I understand, but I still need your help anyway. We have had a major dip in listeners, so you can get that number back up for us by sharing the show with your friends on social media. You can rate us on iTunes. You can copy-paste our links to other people. Guys, you wouldn't believe how powerful a recommendation is in this current market. We weeded the garden, and now we got to water it. All right? Thanks for helping me with that. I really appreciate you guys, and I appreciate the encouragement you've been sending me through the website, Facebook page, at the Right to Reason 1 on Twitter. I love you guys. I really appreciate it. All right. Enough of this bullshit. Enough of this emotional stuff. Let's talk about the show. It's awesome. If they were pissed off before, they're going to be real pissed off now because Steve Hill is about to keep it real for us. Real talk. Sorry. That's my new thing. You guys heard R. Kelly Real Talk yet? It was on the Joe Rogan Experience recently, and then it's just totally gone viral and been on a couple other podcasts. And all right, I'm gonna play you a quick snippet so we don't get sued. I can't play you the whole thing. All right. Real talk, always accusing me of some old bullshit when I'm just trying to have a good time. Robert, you did this. I heard you did that. Don't you think I got enough bullshit on my mind? Real talk. Enough bullshit on my mind. Didn't I just give you money to go get your hair, toes, and nails done another day? Mm-hmm. Your ass was smiling then. Real talk. Gave who some damn money? Today we'll be talking to stand-up comedian Steve Hill. He is hilarious. This guy's crazy. He ran for state senator as a Satanist. Awesome guy. You ready to get started?
And let me assure you that we are going to take our fight for economic justice, for social justice, for environmental sanity, for a world of peace.
And I think it should be religion treated with ridicule and hatred and contempt. And I claim that right.
One aspect of American U.S. life and culture that I think that does deserve respect and admiration is protection of freedom of speech. The U.S. is unique in the world in that respect.
The cosmos is also within us. We're made of star stuff. We are a way of the cosmos to know itself.
Quoting the Bible is not going to get you anywhere because you haven't demonstrated why anybody should consider the Bible to be true or authoritative.
We must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex.
Question: what makes something funny? We're going to ask Steve Hill about that. He will also be talking to us about the housing collapse, his candidacy, Colin Kaepernick, Black Lives Matter, the current prison system, Trump, MLK Jr., poverty, stand-up, mythicist Milwaukee. Here's a big question. Does the secular community ignore its black members? And also, we touch on the recent Neil deGrasse Tyson sexual assault allegations. We'll talk. We cover a lot of stuff here. It'll be a great conversation. Steve has me thinking about these complex issues as much as he has me laughing about them. To give you a little background understanding of the guy, I'll play a segment of a stand-up for you here in just a second. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show.
Culture is not your friend. Culture is for other people's convenience and the convenience of various institutions, churches, companies.
We very naturally, as a cognitive and behavioral imperative, we form descriptions of the world and we try to figure out what's going on.
You basically the design of rockets on science, they reach the moon. It works. Bitches.
By a round of applause, how many atheists do we have in the house? All right, same thing. How many humanists do we have in the house? Okay, now let me tell you something, because I saw both people clapping for everything. Let me tell you, my humanist friends out there, I'm gonna let you in on something. You're an atheist. I know it's hard just saying, I'm an atheist. Try doing it while black. Yes! That's right, man. It's tough, man. I know, it's tough, man. Black people, I call this the family and friends program when you're a black atheist. You know why? Because you lose family and friends. Let me give y'all an example, man. I mean, it's hard, because you gotta come out like you're gay. To tell people you're an atheist? Check this out. Got this friend named Jerry, right? We've been friends together forever. I mean, I saw him fall in love, get married, have kids, saw him buy his first house. Everything going along just beautiful. All of a sudden, Jerry asked me one day, he goes, Steve, could you be my kid's godparent? Time for us to have a little talk, Jerry. We'll talk. Now check this out. I told him like this, you know, I tried to break it to him as simply as I could. Jerry, I'm gonna tell you something. You know I love you, I love Cindy. Kids are beautiful, they're getting straight A's. But I can't be no godparent, man. I'm an atheist. Dun dun dun! Jerry looking at me like, so what, Steve? I don't care if you're an atheist, so what? Fuck, I don't care. You're already black. Who gives a fuck?
All right, we are here with Steve Hill. Atheist, stand-up comedian, what, Satanist, former state senator candidate. Pretty big resume, Steve. You've done about everything, haven't you?
Yeah, I've done everything except run for president of the moon.
You're in real estate now, too, is that right?
Yeah, I've been a real estate appraiser for about 14 years. Started before the mortgage meltdown thing happened. And yeah, I appraise real estate.
I bought my house right in 2008. And like right after that happened, it has gone through so many different banks that, it's like every other month, some new bank gets it. And they just keep changing it around. Does that have something to do with the collapse, banks going under? In fact, you know what? I can't think of the name of the first bank that I had, but it was one of the names that popped up right away whenever the collapse happened that went under.
Could that be Citibank?
It wasn't Citibank, but it started with a C.
Could that be Countrywide?
There it is. Countrywide, yeah.
Hey, I know all the co-conspirators in that meltdown, man.
Oh, my God.
That had a huge impact on the area of North Los Angeles County where I live, because it's basically a bedroom community. People, a lot of people drive in to LA, you know, for higher paying jobs. But that heavily impacted this area, man. You know, all I was appraising for a while were distressed properties, you know, foreclosures, REOs, defaults. Just it was horrible. It was kind of traumatic to go through. It's like devastation in your entire community. You see all these people uprooted, kids uprooted from their schools, and nobody really talks about that aspect of the mortgage meltdown, but it actually affected, you know, real live everyday human beings, you know?
Did you notice how the conservative BS message that they were putting out there, I mean, I saw it all over Fox News and everything, was that it's the poor people that caused this. For some reason, it was like blame the victim routine with them. Freddie Mae and Fannie Mae and all that, you know, it was all the poor people's fault for taking up all the money, and then look what they did to the rest of us. It made me sick to my stomach.
Actually, those people at the lower end of the economic ladder.
Screwed. Yeah,
exactly. They became unwittingly pawns in the whole procedure, where the mortgage brokers, all the banks, since no one was really checking for income verification or things, you know, little things like that, that may or may not determine if you can pay off this huge mortgage. They didn't care, because they were selling these loans so quickly on the secondary money markets that by the time these loans started to default, they were owned by other people. Just like you were saying before about the houses, man, sometimes I would get to a house to appraise it, and there would be like two owners there. Like, what? No, only one of you own this property. So you guys straighten it out, and I'll come back and appraise it later.
Oh, my God.
But yeah, that's how quickly these loans were, you know, being sucked up, bought up, and it was a mess. And a lot of people in the poor communities, they were victimized. B of A paid, I don't know how many gazillions out in fines. Wells Fargo, they definitely, and they're one of my biggest clients, they definitely marketed to the African-American community specifically, and here in Los Angeles, also the Latino Hispanic community. But yeah, we were basically victimized. We African-Americans, I'm sure, lost zillions of dollars in generational wealth, but now because your parents don't have equity built up into some real estate or some property where they may have could have used it to leverage it to put you through college, now they have nothing. So it's going to be, you know, tough for people starting out again. We'll
talk. What the hell, Steve? How did we get off on this? I wanted to ask you about you ran for state senator, man. Like, we just started right up. You're easy to talk to.
Yeah.
But anyway, so tell me about this running for state senator, and well, I wanted to ask you about your comedy act.
Yeah, we'll start with this run for state senate. That was last year, 2016. Remember that monumental 2016 election that no one will ever forget.
Crazy.
Anyway, there was four of us running for the 21st Senate District in the state of California, and I basically ran as a black Satanist and came in third, if you can believe that. Somebody lost to a Satanist, a black one. Like, how'd you like to have that on your resume? I lost to a black Satanist.
But that makes the Satanist sound cooler, like black Satanist, you know?
Yeah.
Like black belt in Satanism, you know? Like, it's that one level up.
Yeah, you definitely got to kick it up a notch. You're going to be black and a Satanist. Black and a Satanist. Yeah, man, I'm a Satanist. I got one tenet. I know my friends over at the Satanic Temple, they got seven tenets. I got one tenet. You know what it is?
What?
Don't be a fucking asshole.
That's about it. If you can follow that, you're a better person.
You can follow that, you can roll with Satan. How about that?
Can you explain to anybody that hears that and go, well, how can you be a Satanist and an atheist at the same time? Like, people that don't understand Satanism, they think that it's maybe just a bunch of candles, robes, and stabbing babies.
Well, let me just give you my perspective. I'm a comedian and a very satirical, very witty, snippy individual. If you can have faith and worship a guy that's, to me, is complete fantasy, then I have the right to worship his adversary.
Right.
Which would be Satan. And how could you look down on me? But if you want me to give validity to that bullshit you believe, but then you can't, you know, give no credit to what I believe, even though I'm a Satanist. Think about that. Think about the hypocrisy in that. You want me to, you know, respect how you think, but you can't respect how I think. So basically, it's like I'm the biggest religious troll you can imagine.
How do they not see that Satan wasn't really as bad as God in the Bible? Like, he killed, I mean, he did kill some people.
Well, look at God.
Imagine we talk about people that way. Like, he killed a couple folks, but he's not a bad guy.
And I imagine some of them were very good people.
Yeah. He's a rapist.
Yeah. Right. But, you know, it's to me, man, it's just purely satirical. You know, it's a joke to me. To me, now the Satanists, some Satanists I know, they get very, you know, involved in the whole culture of Satanism, the folly, the what is it? What do you call the ritualistic aspects?
Yeah, and worshiping. And, I don't like know. You don't
Come
worship.
On, man. I got other shit to do. You know what I mean? I got a business to run. I'm politically active in my community. I got all kinds of things to do besides to really get off into some mythical. You know, I understand it, though. I understand why they do it. The imagery, the projection, going out to be something other than, you know, the yin to the yang. I understand yeah. I get that. But
a way to
as
identify,
far as
it's
really
identity.
Believing, as far as like, ooh, I really like, come on, stop. It's a joke. I'm just fucking with people. All right.
So it's a way for you to make a message about it, more or less. Like you're trying to make people question their beliefs.
Right. Yeah. And it's basically, I look at it as like, okay, if you say you're an atheist, people automatically look at you funny. They start judging you. They ridicule you, you know, the persecution thing. But if you tell them you're a Satanist.
Oh, shit.
Oh, you just stepped it up a level. Like, wait a minute. Now you're talking to something they can relate to. Because all of their lives, their minds have been conditioned and manipulated to respect and fear Satan.
Mm.
So, okay, if that's what it takes for me to get my message to you, then okay, now that we've got that out of the way, let's talk about some real shit like helping kids get through school and helping children how to handle being bullied and real shit that affect children. You know, I support a local program by the Sheriff's Department. Which the Sheriff's Department is not a big friend of mine, but when they do good stuff, I try to help. It's called the VITA program, Vital Intervention and Directional Alternatives for Youth. And I started working with them purely to try to keep some of the kids out of prison, to, you know, stop that school to prison pipeline per se, because it's actually real. You know, it's some real things. And these children, a lot of them are really suffering. And once you get stuck in that system, you don't get out.
It goes and like counsels them like a big brother thing.
Yeah, it's kind of like a little paramilitary Marine Corps type of like a boot camp on the weekend.
Teaches them discipline and stuff.
Yeah, it teaches them. Yeah. And, you know, I'm a former Marine. So, you know, the program was full of former Marines that I could relate to. And they actually cared about the kids. So I used to, donate my time. But then when I ran out of time, I do fundraisers. For them, I did one a few weeks ago, and I raised money for the kids, the at-risk youth. They can get in to the program. I think it's like $70, but you'd be surprised how many people in the area doesn't have, you know, they don't have $70. That's like paying the light bill or something, you know?
Right, right. So, am I going to eat today, so or am I going to do this? Yeah.
Raise money to get additional kids into the program. It's a worthy program. You know, I was a correctional officer for 10 years, right?
I didn't know that. I mean, you really have done everything, man.
Yeah, I worked in two different...
Before you get to that, if people wanted to help support that, how could they find that on the internet or something?
Just VIDA, Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department. Put that in Google, and it will come up.
Were you a cool cop?
Were
you kind of a dick?
No, not initially. I was, you know, until you get out of the academy and get around other officers that have been doing it for a long time, and you kind of adopt the right approach that you take, you know, you could be considered a jerk.
Yeah.
But then, you know, after a few years, I kind of settled into just a good groove of just treating these guys like they're human beings, you know, no matter what atrocity they committed to get themselves into prison. But you treat people with dignity and respect, even though they wear the garments of an inmate or a convicted felon, and it makes your job easier and you feel better about yourself, you know?
Hmm.
So, yeah, I was at the end there. I was a really consider myself a really good correctional officer. You know, and this wasn't caught on tape, but I do remember one time stepping in between a inmate and an officer. The officer, he couldn't realize that the hostilities and the physical altercation had ceased because both of the inmates had kind of stopped. But he was still gearing up to take another swing, and I was like, "Oh no!" And I stepped in between.
They saw that, though. The inmates probably saw that and thought, he gives a fuck."
Oh, for sure. And I got the best compliment I ever got from the inmates, which they called me a nigger while doing it. The black inmates. Oh, they said, "Oh, House Nigger Hill did something good on the yard. You know, he did this or that." I was like, okay, if that's a compliment coming from the inmates, I'll take it. All right.
they were accepting you.
Yeah. They were just trying to give an acknowledgement. It's like, okay, that's about as best you're going to get out of an inmate anyway. So
is it like constantly people just talking shit to you all the time with a job like that?
No. I mean, there was some black inmates that really, really hated me. And yeah. I know it. You could just feel it every time they come around, or you have to pat them down in the cell block or going in or out to the yard. But just did a little bit deeper thinking, and it's like, you know, these guys really don't hate me because they don't even fucking know me, for one. They hate this uniform I'm wearing. That's what they hate. They hate the uniform. And yeah. You deal with it from that perspective. Yeah. Yeah, but like I said, man, at the end there, those last maybe 4 or 5 years, I had the respect of everybody at the institution. Any yard that I walked on, you know, all the staff, all the inmates. Shit, I could walk the prison yard by myself with no other officers there and felt safe because nothing was gonna happen. Not to me.
Is there as much rape as they show like on TV? Like, is it just constant shower rapes going on in prisons?
No, it's not just constant shower rapes going on. There's
just all the time.
No. I mean, there. Of course, that stuff happens. It's real, but it's not. A constant.
I mean, that's the first thing you think, right? Like, if you're gonna, well, I don't know about you. I mean, you've had that job, so you know what it looks like. But for the rest of us that haven't been around the prison system, the first thing I think is, if I go to prison, oh no, I'm gonna get raped. You know, yeah. Like that's the big fear. It's even that's scarier than the being incarcerated feeling. You know?
Yeah. I mean, it happens. It happens, man. You have guys, extorting other guys for their canteen or their phone calls or. You know, it's a whole sub world community, but I'm gonna tell you, it's not all bad because there's also a certain air of respectability in a prison and honor because what you say in a prison setting, your word is all you really have. You know, if you tell somebody you're gonna do something, like as an officer, I do it no matter what. I don't care if I have to get back into the prison. If I told you I was going to hand you 2 rolls of toilet paper and I forget to do it before the end of my, I'll either call or come back like here's, but man, once you lose your word and people are inmates, officers see you just full of shit, you are actually in danger.
Wow.
Because people don't, you know, it's just something about your word and your honor in a prison setting. And I wish it could be more like that out on the street. If people had to live like that out on the street, say what you do what you say, mean that shit. You know, carry through, follow through. It'd be a much better world out here. But, you know, most people are full of shit, so.
Ain't that the truth? Your former Marine, what do you feel whenever you see these guys kneeling during the anthem? Does that piss you off as a military officer?
I feel like I put my ass on the line for you to do and protest whatever the fuck you want to do.
Hell yeah.
Part of your freedom that I served for was for you to express yourself. Especially if you're being oppressed, minimalized, or just downright disrespected. So yeah, it nothing to me. And plus, let me tell you, all of that is bullshit anyway. Because when you know they bring in the flag, they bring in the cops, they bring in the fucking firefighters, they bring in the Boy Scouts. None of that has no one. They're bringing in everything except why Colin Kaepernick was taking a knee. Think about that.
Yeah, they don't want to talk about that.
We don't talk about.
Yeah.
But they bring in every other thing that they can think of to drag it in to make you seem less patriotic or less deserving of any issue that you're, you know, protesting. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. And I don't see how people fall for it.
Yeah, people will say something about, like, same complaint they'll have with Black Lives Matter or something, where they'll say, well, look at, you know, they're holding up the street. You know, what if there's an emergency vehicle there? And I'm like, okay, but I can give you emergency vehicle stuff like that a little bit, you know, but still, if they weren't protesting this way, you know, which first of all, how are you going to tell somebody how they're supposed to protest? That's bullshit. But even if they weren't doing this thing that's particularly bothering you, you wouldn't be noticing what they're trying to get you to notice. That, you know, so what's the, how are they supposed to get their message to you if they don't do something that gets your attention? But then, like you say, now that they got your attention, you're making it about something else. You're going, oh, you don't support the troops. And he's going, no, it's just cops are beating the shit out of black people. I just want you to see cops are beating the shit out of black people. Can't you get that? Yeah.
Yeah, it's the biggest bait and switch I've ever seen pulled off in this country.
Get like, that here, son of a bitch off the field. Remember that?
Yeah, let's not talk about that, though. Let's talk about our troops and our you're disrespecting our cops. You know, and then they go, well, why do we have to be a football player? Well, why not? Who has a bigger platform? Do they listen to trash men or janitors when they start fucking protesting? No, they don't. Matter of fact, Martin Luther King was killed in 1968 in Memphis because he was down there trying to give voice to trash men that were on strike and protesting. So, yeah, you got a big platform. You got a gigantic audience. It takes an enormous amount of balls to have an audience that big and protest if you're on the field. Think about that. Think about how quiet a lot of our athletes have been with all of this shit going on, with all of these brothers being shot and killed by the police, which been happening for years, long before Rodney King or anybody else. But, you know, think about it.
All these representatives representing the very communities that are being treated this way, staying silent. And then somebody finally stands up. And, you know, the crazy thing is, originally, he just sat down. That was the first thing he did. He said, I'm just going to sit down during it. And then a military officer that was a friend of his said, hey, why don't you just take a knee? That way you're not disrespecting the flag or anything. And, you know, you're a football player. You guys take a knee. It's time to think things over. It's time to rest and recapitulate and, you know, all that kind of. And it made perfect sense. So really what he's doing was a way to maintain a form of respect, but that's just not good enough. It's not good enough.
Right. Not good enough. We want you to stand all the way.
Yeah.
And after you finish that, we want you to pick this goddamn cotton.
Yeah. Go suck an army guy's dick.
it's like, wait a minute. We don't want you protesting in the middle of our display of racism. Like, why? That's disrespectful to us. Think about it, man. It's like the flag doesn't mean everything to everybody. You know, it means certain different things for us. Just like that Confederate battle flag that's supposed to somehow represent ethnic heritage in the South, which, okay, I understand that. But you fuckers committed treason and basically lost, and now you have the flag to prove it. So you want to wave it around. It's purely another symbol of racism. And anybody with a fucking brain knows that. But they want you to respect it. I mean, the stars and stripes, I can respect some of it, but come on. All of our history?
Yeah, some part of our history we need to be ashamed of.
Right.
And some of it we need to respect. And all of it should be given this kind of whitewashed kind of level of respect. Well, how are you going to learn a damn thing if you treat your past that way? How are you ever going to get better if there's not certain things that you say, hey, we can't go back to that, you know?
Yeah, it's like a rapist telling his rape victim, you better not call the police. You better not bring any attention to what I've just done to you.
Well, I mean, that's how it happens, right? I mean, anybody that's the abuser always tries to silence the victim naturally because that's going to... You're absolutely right.
And we have been, you know, this is probably no surprise to nobody, but I'm 56 years old, and we have been being killed and shot and abused by the police for a long time. I mean, look at that George Kennedy video in L.A. where they beat the shit out of Rodney King on the street. And that was long before, you know, smartphones. Mm. That was just the odds were just astronomical that somebody would have a big ass VHS camera on their shoulder filming that beating. But in L.A., man, I could tell you, and I've lived in L.A. County for a long time. That shit was the norm. You know, the riots broke out when I was a correctional officer up at Tehachapi, CCI, California Correctional Institution at Tehachapi. And I actually had officers standing next to me in the control booth in the cell block cheering on the riots. because it was going to create more overtime. Wow. I was like, wow, what an inhumane bastard you are. You want to get more overtime shifts in, and people are literally like dying, looting, robbing, and, you know, creating total chaos on the street. But all you can do is cheer, you heartless, sick bastard. But those are the kind of officers, man. And it's a, you know, it's another thing I'd like to discuss, man. People don't understand where all this racism comes from in these police departments. They don't know that in our military, we have a lot of racist white Christian guys that sign up for the military and they feel like they're patriots and warriors. But these are the same guys that hate blacks and Mexicans and LGBT and, you know, bigots. And then when they're finished with the military, they grease the skids for these guys to go straight into these police departments to carry it. Now you got a fucking racist with legal authority working under the color of the law who has a gun assigned to him and a badge. And these are the same guys that I saw in the military that were really fucking just racist. And now they're out in the streets making sure, and this is how they feel. They make sure that, you know, we're going to keep these black guys in their place. This is, you know, that's the biggest part of my job, is keeping black men in their place. And they actually believe this shit. Well, and this is how it happens.
How do we keep from that happening? Like, should there be some kind of psychological testing to prevent this, or how do we stop it?
That could be a slippery slope, because now you're trying to, you know, get into people's head and see how they really think, which no one will ever know. I mean, racists can, you know, they can create whatever kind of facade, whatever it takes to get them into the job. So I just say everybody keep your damn body cam on.
Yeah. That would help a lot.
Keep the body cam on. It's no reason for turning it off, especially when you're engaging the public.
Well, in my city, they don't even have to have body cams. So, I mean, a lot of these states don't even enforce that rule. So there's one right there.
I actually think it would protect a lot of officers, and it would protect a lot of civilians.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, you know, it's a mess. But, you know, if people weren't racist, we wouldn't have to deal with all of this bullshit.
And it's not just... I think that's one of the things is someone that's, let's say a white conservative guy hears you say what you just said, right? And he thinks, well, hold on. I'm not racist, but I support the cops. I'm not racist, but that. And I kind of feel like one of the things that they miss, and help me out here, but one of the things that they miss is where Steve is saying racism is this major problem, and he's kind of showing how it can develop even from back pre-police career, back in the military, or even before that. But even if the individual in particular isn't racist, there's a systemic issue that we're fighting as well, that we're having to deal with. And I think that's what Kaepernick and Black Lives Matter and that sort of thing is. They're not just saying, I mean, they want to make that clear. Hey, there's some real racist stuff going on where people are intentionally making decisions based on hate. But there's also within the system itself. And I think you touched on that whenever you were saying some of your coworkers were excited about the riots that were going on, and how the prison system itself, they lobby our government to put people in jail for minor, you know, victimless crimes all the time.
Because this is
a money making industry, especially with the private prisons and stuff like that. So there's some systemic problems that I kind of feel like sometimes whenever somebody will hear something that you're saying and they say, well, that doesn't apply to me. Right, yeah. But the system is something that you're responsible for too, okay?
Right.
And I just feel like that's a common defense mechanism on a lot of white America, or with their response is, I don't hate black people, so I can just dismiss all of this stuff. And it's like, whoa, you don't get it. The laws that are in place now were written by people that did, so we need to make changes. And I think they missed that.
Yeah, it's... Man, it goes way back.
Yeah.
I mean, the mechanics of systemic racism and stipulations and legal language, the slave codes back in the 1600s. I mean, it goes way back. And the system is totally designed to keep us as second class citizens. That's the only real way you could see it.
Even with the Kaepernick thing where they're saying, you know, he's disrespecting the Star Spangled Banner, Oh Say Can You See by the Dawn's Early Light. You know, we all know that first verse.
Yeah, we know that verse where they tell you that, oh, well, slaves can catch a beat down too if they jump up.
Yeah, it says, let's see here. If you go three verses down, no refuge could save the hireling and slave from the terror of flight or the gloom of the grave. And a lot of people don't want to think about how, you know, okay, you want the Star Spangled Banner to be respected, and I understand that. Okay, I understand where you're coming from. But just like I was saying a minute ago, these systemic problems that are coming, even if you're not racist, these laws were written by racist people. And you say, what? How do you know? Perfect example, Star Spangled Banner. You're not singing it in a racist way, but the guy that wrote it was clearly racist. So, like, that's a perfect analogy of how this happens right there. And that's what we need to deal with along with the blatant racism.
Right. Yeah. This racism is this insidious parasite that absolutely retards our system from being fully humanistic and fully developed as human beings. We are going to go into a state of regression, because if we can't learn how to live together, we're not going to be operating at our maximum potential ever, because we're too busy fighting against each other, hating each other, war. I mean, it's a horrible way to live. But in America, if anybody can get it right, and black people we have done a lot to make sure this country try to live up to the bullshit that it says it is. You know, all of that land of the free bullshit. How you gonna say you the land of the free and you got fucking slaves?
Yeah.
And you know, our forefathers didn't write none of that shit. But then again, black people, all the black people I know, we are some of the most patriotic citizens of the community, of the country. Like, where can we go? We ain't going back to Africa. That's not gonna happen. I mean, I still own land down in Mississippi that my great grandfather was sharecropping back in the 20s, late 1800s. It's like, I have culture too. I mean, I grew up hunting, fishing. I'm good with a rifle from my time in the department. Shit, I could shoot a dime out of a billy goat's ass at 500 meters.
Never heard that expression before.
Oh yeah, I'm good at it. You know, fishing. I love fishing and doing all that country shit, because that's how my father grew up. So I can understand the whole Second Amendment gun rights thing. And, you know, I'm more American than anybody could ever imagine. Imagine that. Satan is a black American. but yeah, man, it's like, don't try to tell, you know, don't try to make me seem less patriotic because I'm not happy with the amount of oppression that you have, you know, given us.
Yeah.
It's a lot to unwrap. It's a lot of history to go through. But people have to understand that system, the mechanics of holding people back. And, you know, we can go into this shit as far as why do we have the interaction between the cops and black men all the time? Why are our prisons, which I can account for, I can fucking pretty much verify, why are our prisons, like, damn near half the population of any state prison is going to be African-American males, unless you're in, like, Utah or Wyoming or some North Dakota. But as far as California, we make up 6% of the population, but we make up 46 to 48% of the prison population. That's letting you know something is wrong with the fucking system. The numbers don't jive. The numbers don't match up. And until we can change that economic conditions to where black men have to steal, sell drugs, or do things on the other side of the law to keep us out of these prisons, until we can get jobs, until we can get education, until we can find, you know, ways to raise our family and support our people without going to prison, it's going to continue to be fucked up. That's just how it is. Until we realize that, and one of the best things we could do is to drop this religion bullshit, which nobody talks about, and nobody's hard enough on black people in this religion shit. Because if we stop that and dealt with what's real, what we really need to do, like educate our kids and keep them out of the correctional facilities and out of these courtrooms, until we learn how to do that on a realistic basis without thinking some white guy is going to drop down and start giving out, you know, granting wishes and shit, we're going to be, you know, we are going to be retarding our own progress.
Do you think that that's that's part of what caused this whole Trump backlash was racism itself. Do you think that having like two terms of a black president was a major catalyst for what's going on, that we'll have a president now that would act the way, like, that his bullshit response to Charlottesville, or the way that he's responding to Kaepernick and that sort of thing? I mean, obviously, I don't know that it's obvious, but it certainly seems like this is a response to race.
Yeah, I think it was more or less a mixture of it being actually just a perfect storm of voter apathy. And with the other side, Donald Trump brought out, you know, that true part of America that only black people, I think, really know exists, that about 30% of this country's population are really, really fucking racist. And he motivated all of them to come out. And then on the other side, you had a candidate that wasn't very likable, Hillary Clinton, who was more of a corporatist Democrat, who her and her husband put a lot of black people in prison. So, you know, the Democratic base is basically black people and, you know, white liberals.
What did she call the, it was like
super predators.
Yeah.
Super predators. But that was when, you know, we had crack dealings and a drug epidemic that, you know, you didn't have this sympathetic ear like you have now with the opioid crisis. You know, you got, we have to take care of these people. They were lock them up. Fucking black people, drugs, drug dealers, lock them up. Let's build prisons. Shit, I know when I joined the department, California was building so many prisons, man. They were going up like tract homes. Like, damn. But now it's a totally different approach. But yeah, Hillary and Bill, you know, and Bill was partially responsible for the mortgage meltdown, because a lot of the deregulation, they dismantled the Glass-Steagall Act, which basically kept these banks from becoming casinos. And
yeah, liberals don't want to admit that one, do we?
No, but it's a whole lot, you know. But I held my nose, and I knew that just because of math, logic, and common sense, you knew that you have to vote for Hillary. And that's what I did, even though I was a staunch Bernie supporter. Oh, I was, man.
You and me both, man. You and me both.
I stood behind him at a rally. I got a picture. I was in the peanut gallery behind him.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
Throwing up my horns. But yeah, somebody took a picture of people.
Oh, you gotta send that to me. I'd love to see that.
Yeah, I'll post it. I'll post it again on Facebook.
That's cool.
But yeah, man, that perfect storm is what gave us Donald Trump. And then you have these people who insist on my vote don't matter, so I don't vote. These are some of the most ignorant motherfuckers in America, and I blame them partially for staying home, because we couldn't risk it. We couldn't risk not voting. And you know, since Bernie wasn't the nominee, we only had one real viable option. Gary Johnson, Captain Aleppo, he wasn't a fucking option. Jill Stein, they were never going to get the numbers that Hillary was going to get. So you go with the person that's going to get the numbers to win. But that's not what happened. So we have Donald Trump, and the fucking racist won.
Yeah, and with his response to NFL fires these people or kicks them off the field or something like that.
Yeah, get these son of a bitches off the field. What president do you know talk like that?
Never before. And while you were talking about it, it made me think about, I had recently, just because of all this stuff, pulled up Martin Luther King's letter from a Birmingham jail. A lot of people don't know that he really wrote it from jail. You know, like it's a crazy, and they were locking him up for what he said. And this, at the very end of it, he's talking about how we should respond to demonstrations about race. Hopefully it's not too long, but I wanted to read it for the listeners real quick. I wish you had commended the Negro sit-inners and demonstrators of Birmingham for their sublime courage, their willingness to suffer, and their amazing discipline in the midst of great provocation. And just to interject here, this is how a real American, this is how a man, this is how someone with compassion response to this sort of thing, not saying get that son of a bitch, you know, that
he's catering to his base. That whole NFL thing, he was catering to his base, because I can go back on Facebook on my post. I was posting things about the four troops that had died, and I was like, why is no one bringing this up? Why is no one talking about this? And he, you know, he's all over this NFL thing.
Distraction. I'm going to distract you with racism.
Throwing meat to his base to keep them, you know, keep them riled up, keep them going. And it makes him feel good because, you know, his base is going to love him. Like he said, he could go out in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody in the forehead and wouldn't lose a supporter.
He was right. He finishes off. He says, I hope this letter finds you strong in faith. I also hope the circumstances will soon make it possible for me to meet each of you, not as an integrationalist or a civil rights leader, but as a fellow clergyman and a Christian brother. Let us all hope that these dark clouds of racial prejudice will soon pass away and the deep fog of misunderstanding will be lifted from our fear-drenched communities. Fear-drenched communities, that hits me right there. And in some not too distant tomorrow, the radiant stars of love and brotherhood will shine over a great nation with all their scintillating beauty. And it's not here yet. You know, he was killed shortly after that. Still haven't lifted this deep fog. And I think everybody thought we did. So, we, you know, you always hear people say, well, let's just quit talking about it. Just that's what's causing all this is people keep bringing it up. You're pulling the race card, right? Quit pulling the race card all the time. And I think we were all, not all of us, but a lot of America was thinking, we're past this. We have a black president. It's done. And we're seeing that deep fog never left. Yeah. We still have it here.
Yeah, part of the problem in this country, man, is people live within bubbles. I see it in my own town when I'm appraising real estate. We have a divide called the 14 Freeway, and the east side is low income, entry level houses, and the west side is more affluent, you know, gated communities. And a lot of people from the west side and they never go to the east side. They never see the people that are walking around over there with shopping carts, picking up aluminum cans, the people that are, you know, people are walking around that you can just look at them and tell that they have an obvious mental problem, or else you wouldn't come out the house looking like that. but because, you know, we live in our bubbles and we stay on our side and we shop here. And it's the same thing with a lot of these industries, you know, people that work. We have aerospace here. People that work for Northrop, you know, for their job security, man, they will cheer on a war. Afghanistan, Iraq, they want to keep that going as long as possible because it's job security for them. So people live within these bubbles, man. And I think that's how a lot of white people with the election of Barack Obama assumed that there was no more racism.
Yeah.
But then they don't go into the inner city and they don't, you know, until cell phones came along, they didn't realize how many blacks were being killed or beat, shot by the police, harassed, you know, stop and frisk. What kind of shit is that? I'm just walking down the street and you think you have the right to stop me and put your hands on my body because I may or may not be carrying illegal substances or guns or knives. What kind of shit is that?
And they tried to make it about terrorism. Oh, because of 9/11, we have to do stop and frisk now. Wait a minute, right. What the... How many times are you just stopping people and preventing terrorism?
Right.
What a weird correlation you're making here. And it's the same thing of I'm going to take a knee because we need to deal with, you know, the systemic racism that's affecting our communities. And everybody says, wait a minute, you don't care about the troops. Well, I mean, what did your president say about the troops? What did he say? He knew what he was getting into. Remember that?
Yeah.
He don't give a fuck about the troops.
He has not one compassionate bone in his body.
With his heel, well, he's got that heel spur. He couldn't serve.
Yeah.
With that.
Yeah. Yeah. He could.
He would have been there. Come on, Trump would have been out there.
I remember growing up in that era. I had a brother that was over in Vietnam. I had another brother in Okinawa. I remember growing up, people, you know, were doing what they could to get out of going to Vietnam, getting out of going to the military. And I just think back now that Trump, you know, with all of that money and his dad being a rich real estate developer in a big city like New York, he had very little chance of ever seeing a boot camp, war, anything like very little chance. You know, a lot of people did that. But now these are the same, you know, politicians that are running around ranting about how you better respect the flag, but you couldn't go serve your goddamn country. I mean, I got people in my family. And it's documented in the library in Mississippi. I have people in my family line that fought in the Civil War. My father fought in World War II. He actually fought in World War II. My brother fought in Vietnam. My other brother, you know, we had 4 or 5 people in our family from military service. But it came out of, you know, this is what you should do. this, you should serve your country. I always thought that, always knew, you know, that I was going to the Marine Corps when I graduated high school, because that's kind of what we did in our family. We wouldn't serve, did your duty, and then moved on to something else. But these politicians, man, they use that shit, and it just creates animosity. That's all it does.
Did you see that latest Dave Chappelle stand-up? He did a special on Netflix. He's talking about World War II, and he's saying, "What? Of course the civil rights happened after that." He says, think about it. These black guys served just like the white folk did, and they're over in Europe getting their dick sucked. They're in Europe, so it's by white women. They come back here. You think they're going to take any of your shit now? He's like, they ain't going to take any shit. That's the civil rights movement happened.
Yeah, man. Dave Chappelle is a good comedian. I don't... As a comedian, I don't listen or even watch other comedians.
Really?
Yeah, because, you know, it's just a thing. Most comedians are like this. You want your own way of thinking. You want to write your own material. You don't want anybody else's way of thinking to get into your, you know, point of view or perspective on comedy or situations or your life experiences. So most comedians don't watch other comedians.
Wow. I would have thought it would have been like a... You know, you take a little bit from this guy, take a little bit from this guy, and just kind of form your own thing as like an amalgam of something.
Nah, man, you got to hit these comedy clubs in L.A., man. Comics get really, really upset. If they even think you're stealing somebody else's material, they, wow, it's an unwritten law. You don't infringe on or take nobody else's material.
Yeah, who was that guy? Was it Lopez? Joe Rogan busted out for stealing all the material. Went up on stage and started calling him a like his career went over.
I think it was Mancia or something
Yeah, Carlos Mancia. That's what it was. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was him. I don't even get off into that whole
all the drama.
Let me tell you, man. I'm an activist comic. These cats in L.A. that I'll be going down tomorrow night to do an open mic and work on some material. But these guys, like I said, it's another industry, and they're like crabs in a barrel, scratching who you know. You know, you got to suck up to people and, you know, get in with this group or get in with this mm-hmm. comedy club and try to get on stage. And I don't want to go through that because they're hungry, and that's how they make their money. But I make my money by appraising real estate, so I don't have to get into that whole combative comic against comic. I can just go out and do conferences and, or, you know, fundraisers and say what the fuck I want to say, which is very liberating to me because I like saying what I want to say. So I don't get into the whole regular comedy industry thing. It kind of sucks.
But it's working, man. It's working. Like you said, you were playing at the Ice House too. That's,
yeah.
That's like the coolest everybody's who's anybody's been there, right? Like that's the big one.
Yeah. I prefer the Comedy Store.
Oh, you did the Comedy Store?
Yeah, yeah. I'll post pictures online. Me on the main stage at the Comedy Store in the main room.
That's so cool, man.
I mean, that's where Richard Pryor performed there. He did a special there.
Holy shit!
I mean, I just love performing there, man. It's nice. It's a nice, classy place. Yeah, I've done the Improv, done the Laugh Factory, you know, cool. all of that stuff.
Would you say that you're an activist? That's a comic or a comic that deals with activism, you know, like it, chicken or egg kind of thing.
I'd say I'd have to be an activist first because I can't stop, you know, I can't stop not being and not saying something about, I don't ever have to tell jokes about it. I can go out. Sometimes I do public speaking and I would be real uncomfortable if I just couldn't speak. If I never got on stage and told another joke to put myself, you know, through that because it is a process. With every, you know, as soon as you step on stage, everybody is judging you from the moment you see the first word come out of your mouth, the first joke. So it could be kind of annoying at times.
Could you do it if you had to? Like, you know, like a lot of comics would go like to TV or something. Like if they said, we're going to give you a TV show, leave all that angry bullshit alone. Just be
funny dad,
or whatever.
Hell no, you know? That's what I'm saying. It never happened. That's,
$10 million contract. You couldn't do it?
No, it's not enough money. It's not enough money you could get me to sell out like that and, you know, say what somebody else want me to say. Fuck that. I'd rather do this my way.
What if just for this thing, you got to be funny, but you can't be an activist, but you can be an activist elsewhere. Could you?
I don't know. It would depends on the circumstances.
That's how they get you. They get right when you do that. I don't know. They show you the money.
Yeah, because I don't need the money. Because I don't, you know, I got my, I can make my own money. Yeah. So, it takes a lot out of it when a financial gain isn't involved, you know?
Do you find that the crowd responds differently in different parts of the country to your act? Anytime you do something like, or even a different spot of California, even? Like, do you find that just...
Man, some material I do, I know it makes the crowd uncomfortable, which I don't give a fuck about because I gotta say it, you know? One of the best compliments I ever received was up in Denver. I went and did a conference called Celebrating Secular Diversity. And I think I was the only brother in the room. I mean, Madisa Thomas was sitting in the front row. But for the most part, it's just white people.
Celebrating secular diversity. One black guy.
Yeah. It was a great conference though, man. I mean, those people in Denver, they had their heart in the right place. It's just that, you know, they couldn't get a lot of black people to be in the audience or to buy tickets to the conference, I guess.
Oh, all right. But so then,
it wasn't some bullshit.
It just worked out that way, is what you're saying.
Yeah, right. Okay. You know, it good people. But when I got off stage, this guy that was sitting in the front row, he was sitting about four rows back, and I could tell he was having a good time. But he came up and told me, he's like, man, I just really got to thank you for what you do, because I've never had so much fun being uncomfortable in my life. Because I was telling jokes about racism and all kinds of shit and religion and blacks and
making
them think. some pretty harsh shit, you know. But yeah. He said, yeah, I was uncomfortable. And I, you know, kind of figured that, because when an audience is uncomfortable, it's just a natural reaction. You're going to be just a little bit uncomfortable telling the jokes.
Do you think that that's part of what makes something funny, though? I mean, if you think about what humor is it's almost like, we can't just say directly, hey, here's something that needs to change. Here's something that we don't want to talk about. Even if it's not necessarily activist humor, even if it's just any humor at all, here's something that makes you feel a little taboo, as it were.
Yeah.
And the only way that I can get it to you is to say it in a funny way. And then that laughter, we like that feeling of the laughter, but what we appreciate even more is that underlying message, maybe. I wonder if that's what comedy is?
Yeah, you know? that's what comedy is, man.
Fart jokes, you know, that's still something that's like, oh, you can't say that.
Yeah, the thing about it is, you gotta have a ring of truth to it.
Yeah.
If you don't have that truth there, that's what gets people, man. That's what triggers that really deep, like, belly laugh when, wait a minute, that was fucked up, but it's true, and everybody knows it's true.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how you get the audience on your side. And once you do that, they'll eat out of your hand.
You ever get those hecklers, you know, where you say something, they're like, "Ali, we didn't come here for politics," you know, or something like that?
Nah, never. Never heard people. You know, I've heard people. You know, they want to. You know, I used to do a lot of Obama jokes, and of course. You get a Republican who's had a few drinks think that they can challenge you on that. And I've got that a few times, but I really don't like, because I have actual material and shit that I want to get out on stage. I really don't take a lot of my time addressing hecklers.
Just ignore it.
Most of the time I'll just let it go. And that's, you know, that's what makes comedy hard, because you just got to stay on track, keep your train of thought, keep that joke. You know, the rhythm of that joke that you're telling, you got to keep it going and try to ignore what this drunk idiot over here said, because you don't want to give him any more attention than he needs, which he needs none.
Yeah, like nobody paid to listen to your drunk ass.
Yeah.
You know, like, we're not here for that.
Now, I got some friends in L.A. that's been doing comedy for 25, 30 years that probably people don't even know. But you let a heckler say something to one of them, and they will spend the rest of their time on stage roasting your ass. And I've seen it happen. And it's like, I bet you wish you had to shut your ass up right now.
You better come up with an excuse to go to the bathroom or something and hope he finishes up before you come back, so he's on a new topic.
Right.
Where you're talking about Denver and how they're trying to bring people together. And then this whole Milwaukee bullshit where it looks like they're trying to divide the community. With MythCon and all that.
Elaborate on that. What was the nucleus? What started some bullshit? Because I'm gonna air this right now. I get tired of the fighting in the community people against people. I mean, I think that's how you came across me. I saw someone that I know talking a gang of shit about another person that I know, which I know both of them. And it's like, wait a minute, you guys don't have to air this shit here like this. I mean, if you have something towards someone that you don't like, don't air the shit on Facebook to make it look like, you know,
right,
we're
right.
fighting, which you,
well,
but man, I mean, it's a lot of people in the atheist community don't like me, which I don't give a fuck. It's a lot of people that I see. It's like, okay, but you know, it doesn't stop me from working with somebody. Like, take David Silverman, for instance.
I was just about to bring up David Silverman.
he's the biggest asshole I know.
Is he really?
Yeah.
I was just about to say, I've pissed off two people, and I really didn't mean to, but one of them, I think, was David Silverman. I'm not sure, but he's not talking to me anymore, and I don't know what happened.
Yeah. See, but you know what? If he called me today and said, you know, let's do something, let's work together, I'd do it. Because as atheists, as the secular community, we don't have the fucking luxury of dividing each other. We got to stay together. It's the only chance we got. So when I see two people at it on Facebook, that shit affects me. Like total negativity. It's like, yeah, something I hate to see. It's like someone sticking a fucking electric hot comb on my neck. I mean, it just irritates me to see us fighting. Like,
with Mythicist Milwaukee is they had invited a bunch of these feminism is bullshit, Black Lives Matter is bullshit. You know, like that the shitlord kind of group.
Uh-huh.
That's I don't think we realized it was so large. It was such a large part of the atheist community. And to me, this whole thing was for the best. And a lot of people listening are going to be like, what the fuck, Robert? But no, I think it's for the best because it pulled back the curtain and let us realize we've got some cleanup. We got some housekeeping we need to do. We need to actually start talking about this. And they had
so
invited.
So was that the whole causation?
That was the catalyst, more or less. They invited Sargon of Akkad, Shoe on Head, and one other guy. I can't think of his name right now, but different YouTubers that have gotten famous. That they have said, don't get me wrong, they have said some deep shit. All right, but for the most part, their publicity, their fame has come from shitting on other people that you and I probably have a lot of respect for. And in the atheist community, they're dividers. They're not joiners.
Right.
You know, they're not trying to bring it together. Well, they invited a bunch of those people. So Arn Ra, another guy that ran for state senator, another atheist that ran for state senator.
He's still running. I'm actually helping him.
Oh yeah, I said it past tense. You're right. Currently running for state senator. Very good. And he backed out. Seth Andrews backed out. I backed out in advance, even though I was never invited. I just want to make that clear. No, they didn't care about me. But anyway, so but they they invite all these guys up there, and then Thomas Smith was going to speak anyway, and he was supposed to be debating somebody from Serious Inquiries Only and Opening Arguments that he does with Andrew Torres. But he was supposed to speak anyway and debate somebody. The person that he was going to debate got removed, and they replaced it with Sargon of Akkad. And I don't know if you're familiar with his work, but he does a lot of that anti-feminist stuff. Like he just loves kicking Steve Shives all around the place, you know, on his videos and stuff like that. And so they start to do a debate, and you can pull it up on YouTube. Sargon released it. I don't know if Thomas released it, but he did release a Serious Inquiries episode talking about what happened. So you can kind of get, like, watch it, and then you can kind of get his reason for how it went down thereafter. Mm-hmm. It was just a fiasco, man. The whole crowd was we're Sargon fans. And I kind of felt like Thomas could have done a better job. You can tell he was pretty emotional, and you know, going into a debate real emotional like that, I think kind of set him back. But the Sargon of Akkad guy, that most of their discussion was about a tweet, which you know, it's a little silly right there. You're like, a tweet, really? But the thing that really got this tweet so fired up was that there was this lady that was a victim of sexual assault herself, who was saying, hey, and she was, I think she was from a European politician. I can't remember her name off the top of my head. But she was saying, hey, guys, why don't we stop all this bullying that's going on social media? So Sargon tweets her, I wouldn't even rape you. To be funny, I guess, is his idea of what's funny. And that thing kind of spread. And a lot of the secular community that says, you know, we need to go ahead and be more confrontational, address feminism as if it's something that we need to fight, really supported that and started tweeting people, I wouldn't even rape you. And at one point, you know, Thomas tried to bring that up and the crowd laughs about it and it yelled out, we wouldn't even rape you, you know, something like that. Mm-hmm. And it's just it's a very weird direction that it seems like we're going in this community, or some of us are going, and we're dividing with it. But I think what the right perspective here is to say, hey, this has been happening all along. This has been prevalent. And
yeah.
I think we need to talk about it. I think we need to talk to these people.
That's the thing. That's the thing. You know, no one wants to really discuss these issues, talk about them in a, you know, from a totally civil perspective where you maintain your respectability and you have a you know, an air of respect. Nobody wants to talk about feminism. Nobody wants to talk about racism. You see the thing that goes, that perpetuates this shit is nobody wants to talk about it. That's the common thread, the common element. We always have a problem about things we don't want to talk about. Why? Because we don't fucking talk about it. Yeah. So they never get discussed. They never get hashed out. And the same problems repeat generationally over and over because nobody's like, hey, let's for once sit down, figure this shit out, come up to some concrete solutions so we can move on in the progression of humanity. But nobody wants to talk about it. So problems exist, persist,
and continue. That's one of Sargon's things, is he was saying, you know, I'm not going to apologize for being a white man. It's like, hold on, man. Like, nobody's asking you to apologize for being a white man.
Right. See, that's just another diversionary bullshit.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. I don't own slaves.
Right.
I heard that shit a lot. I don't have any slaves at home. Like, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, we're not talking about that.
Right.
That's not even the argument. Nobody said you own slaves.
We're talking about right here, right now, today.
To me, though, like the major, it seemed like the real prominent response to this is, let's not give them a platform. And I agree with Thinking Atheist. What's his name? I can't think. Seth Andrews. Pulling out, and I agree with R and Ra pulling out, and I even at the same time though agree with Thomas Smith talking to him, because I think that we shouldn't give them a platform in the sense of let's let them redefine our message. No. We don't want that kind of platform. But let's try to ignore them. Oh hell no, we can't just ignore, you know, a cancer and hope it doesn't get bigger. No, right. We need to address it. And the best way to handle bad speech is with good speech. And I think that we need to go ahead and dig in. And, you know, it's that time. We're starting to grow as a group of people all around the world. But just in America, we've gone from, what, like 1% to damn near 10% of atheist community recently.
Social media is going to make those numbers
absolutely
grow.
Absolutely.
Expeditiously. Just continue to grow.
And you think whenever we were 1%, it was like 0.0001 were these very negative kinds of ideas. Well, now that we're getting bigger, so are they. And they are part of our community. And we gotta go ahead and do a little housekeeping. That's all.
Yeah. But if people could just kind of keep their eye on the prize about what the whole thing is about, is the stupidity of fucking religion. If people could kind of just stay focused on that. Because, you know, I noticed that I don't get a lot of speaking engagements or even to come into comedy because they know I'm bringing baggage with me. I'm bringing black people and religion and slavery. And who wants to hear about that? That's negative. So, you know, people affects
your career. Like you get less shows because of that message.
Oh, I'm sure.
Wow. I wouldn't think it would affect.
I'm sure.
Comedy.
Come on, man.
Much,
when's the last conference you've been to where there was a big, you know, panel on Black Lives Matter at a secular conference, which I think it should be because people don't understand the correlation between church and our belief and our progress that we could be making if we weren't relying on some mythical fucking guy up in the sky. Think about the progress we could be making if we dropped religion And people don't really like to bring that into their conferences because now you're going to have a whole bunch of people who are uncomfortable. So they think, but they really don't know that, man. It's a segment of our community, atheist, secular, who are, they live in a bubble and they would like to kind of understand, you know, what are black people so angry about? Well, yeah. Let me tell you, let me shine some fucking light on why we have NFL players taking a knee and why we're, you know, breaking glass and windows in the street because we feel like we're being victimized by the police. You know, I think as intelligent as the atheist community tries to be, you know, everyone kind of worships this whole education. I'm smart. I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson. I can tell you about the Big Bang Theory and how everything started. You know, all of this in super intelligence, Stephen Hawking type shit. And, you know, it's a lot of things that the basic people don't know about black people. Like, let me tell you, you know, we
like it's
struggle.
Not common sense to them. Yeah.
Why do we still have ghettos in the richest nation in the fucking country? Why are black people still living in the ghettos? It doesn't even make sense.
Why can't they drink their water in fucking Detroit?
Right,
how is that still
a
thing? We've known about this for so long, and nobody that is supposed to be representing them is taking care of them.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right.
Hey, did you hear that thing about Neil deGrasse Tyson?
Yeah, I heard about it.
I really hope that's not true. I really hope that's not true.
These idols in our community, you know, that we hold up to these standards, and we look. I actually did a PostaCon a few years ago. Neil deGrasse Tyson was there. I had a front row seat. Place was packed. I mean, it was packed. Had to be 700 people in the conference room. It was packed.
Wow.
And, you know, it's like we look up to these, but they're no more human than anybody else. I mean, if he did, you know, I don't know if he did anything, molested somebody or raped somebody or who knows. But if he did, he's just a fucking human being like the rest of us are.
We're not supposed to have
fallible
religious leaders like, you know, And, and for any listeners that don't know what we're talking about, let's see here. On Patheos is what I'm reading from. It says Neil deGrasse Tyson accused of raping a former student. And this recently just came out from David G. McAfee.
Right.
So hopefully this isn't true, but I would say that what we got it, like, I've seen a lot of our community immediately respond with, that's a bunch of bullshit. And we got to back up and say, hold on, we're the ones that are always talking about, you know,
evidence.
We need to not evidence exactly, but we also in just the way we respond without evidence of saying, let's not just say that whoever accuses a man of rape is a liar right from the beginning. We're supposed to be better than that. And I'm not saying let's just completely blame Neil deGrasse Tyson. I'm saying we need to respond to this the way that we would expect other communities to respond if someone attacked their people that they look up to. There's nothing wrong with looking up to somebody. I don't know. Is it okay to say he's a hero?
That hero thing is subjective because if he was a hero to me, he would be telling with his voice and his platform, he would be telling black people that the reality of this whole thing is that there is no God and you're pretty much responsible for your own success or lack thereof in this life. But he doesn't say that. He doesn't really even call himself an atheist. He doesn't identify as an atheist.
That's true. He's avoided that.
Yeah, I've heard him say, "Oh, I don't have time for that fight." Like, man, if you can't fight for your own people when you see them being treated like shit or walking down a path that they shouldn't be taking, if you can't fight for that, then what will you fight for? You just want a lot of fame and money and TV shows? I mean, what is fulfillment in your life? So yeah, so as a hero. I wouldn't call him a hero. I would just say he's I wouldn't even call him a hero.
I love the shit out of him, though. That's the thing. Like, I love me some Neil deGrasse Tyson. But
yeah, I mean, just the way he speaks, you know, the eloquence in his in his projection that
give you
makes
a boner
people
for science.
It makes people actually think they may not even be that intelligent, but they can. It makes people feel like, hey, I understand that. He explained that in a way that's conducive to me being interested or either learning more about, you know, astrology or science and math.
This is back in 1984. She studied Galactic Astronomy and the Graduate Program of the University of Texas in Austin. She wanted to become the first black female astronaut. And here's her quote. As she said, he offered me a glass of water. I accepted a liquid in a cup made out of a coconut shell. I recall coming back to consciousness briefly. Then next thing I remember is seeing him in the hallway the next day. I have lived in this nightmare for 30 years, and it stops today. So she's saying back when she was his student that he had, I guess Bill Cosby'd her.
How do we know? Without some evidence, I mean, it's her word against his, basically, but why would she just pull this out of her ass from nowhere and create this ruckus to begin with, unless there was some kind of validity attached to it?
I don't even know if we can say that, though, Steve. I mean,
We don't know.
I'm not saying it's not true, but I mean, just being a celebrity, just these sorts of things are going to happen where people are going to try to accuse somebody.
But you know what? When you have accusations like that, there's usually timelines. So if she had a class and he just happened to be the professor of that class, and you can put them in the same place at the same time, and then years later she comes up with this. I mean, there's some kind of there.
Well, the other thing that usually happens, just like with Harvey Weinstein and Bill Cosby and all that, is whenever somebody steps out first. Same thing with Bill Clinton. Somebody steps out first, and then other people go, you know what, I'm not going to let that person be the only face for this, you know, take all of the shame and all of the condemnation. Right. I'm coming out too. And if there is something about this, if we've learned anything from seeing how these sexual assaults go with other people, there's gonna be a lot more coming out with in the social media world we live in. So
yeah,
I guess time will tell there.
It's a ball of mess that we live in these days. But for some reason, I see a glimmer of hope. Because social media, I think, is going to get the people that need to connect and get together and have a voice. I think it's going to assist them a great deal. Connecting. When you start connecting with other humans and you get these factors that motivate you all into one goal or one purpose, I think it's for the good of mankind.
That's what we need.
Because there's a lot of things. I mean, a lot of people didn't know that blacks on the regular get their ass kicked by the police.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people didn't know that. And that's that bubble that we live in. But now you can go online and Google shit, watch 2 or 3 hours of questionable policing tactics.
I can't believe how many topics we've covered. You're an easy guy to talk to, Steve. I really appreciate you coming on here and talking with us. You're a funny guy. How can people find you? What kind of stuff you got coming up? You said you're building a studio, didn't you?
I'm going to do some YouTube stuff, man, because I get tired of, at my age, being in the comedy clubs every night, trying to, you know, there's always drinks and drugs around. So I think I'd like to do a YouTube channel and discuss some issues and topics and things that are important to me in my life.
Some real talk.
Some real talk. Shit that people don't know, man. You know, it's a lot. Most of these problems we have, people just talk on a topical level, but there's some issues that are really, really deep. Like we were talking about before, about this historical systemic racism, that you really takes a while for you to unwind, to make people minds, you know, make them visualize and see how things are and why things are like they are. There's reasons for everything. For all of these situations, for these protests, there's reasons behind it. And until we unwind and get down to the nuts and bolts of why things like they are, you know, most people are going to remain ignorant. So I like to spread a little knowledge and some understanding, man.
I think you've succeeded in that goal today, and I think the listeners appreciate that as well. Mr. Hill, thank you so much for your time. And I'd love to do this again, and maybe we could talk a little bit more about atheist stuff.
we
covered all the politics today, but
we're gonna talk about reason and logic.
Yeah, I'd love to do that, man.
Technology, engineering, art, and math. We're gonna talk about all of that next time.
Oh shit! Yeah,
but it's been good though, man. I'm glad I had an opportunity to chat with you.
Steve was great, and I really loved talking to him. This week, we lost a valuable member of our community, Scott Smith, from recovering from religion this week, murdered his wife, and then killed himself. He leaves behind a son and 3 young daughters, The son's a little bit older and has passed on any financial support, but the three girls really need your help. Jeez, they're like my kids' age. I mean, they're just, they need you right now. They're left without both parents after this horrific tragedy. And we'll have Anthony Magnabosco on here pretty soon to discuss this. He's a good friend of Scott and can maybe help us understand this a little bit more. I mean, I don't know how it's, I don't know if you can ever figure stuff like this out, but it's really, really tragic. Right now you can help out, and believe me, they could use it. Go to GoFundMe.com and click the fund for the Smith girls. I'll include the link in the show notes today. Learn more about the podcast at therighttoreason.com. Music is always brought to you by alaststateofmind.com. Next week, we'll be talking to Anthony Magnabosco, and he's going to be talking to us about street epistemology. Thanks for listening, and keep fighting for your right to reason.